It is a blessing that we are come tonight to be a part of such a marvelous, marvelous occasion. We are here tonight to share with you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. We would like to give our great regards and thanks to Dr. Michael Crusoe, who has blessed us tonight to be able to be a part of such a great gospel campaign. This campaign is an excellent campaign, and we are excited and honored to just be a part of such a campaign on tonight. And we are just thankful for all of those who have took the time to work diligently to make this campaign a great success. For this campaign theme, Timeless Truth in Truthless Times, part number two. And on tonight, it is our task that we would investigate the topic of the Lord's Church in a society that is built and seen with so many different biblical religious institutions in the world today. It is important for us today to ask the question, what church is the church that Jesus died for? It is important that we investigate the Bible to do our best to try to find what saith the scripture. So on tonight, we are going to investigate the word of our God. And we want to show you tonight that there is a church of the New Testament. And we want to study the word of God that you may understand what that institution is. And as we study tonight, I believe it's important that when we show you what the Lord's church is, you'll also be able to identify what the church is not. Whenever you find out what the church is, you'll be able to know what the church is not. It's just like one who would study regular shapes. Everybody knows what a circle is. Once you know what a circle is and you draw it on a piece of paper, no one can come to you and draw a square and tell you that's a circle. Because once you identify with the shape, the outline, the sketch of what a circle is, you are fully aware of the difference between a circle, a square, a triangle, a octagon, and any other shape, because you have been introduced to what a circle truly is. So on tonight, it is our job to introduce you to the circle. It is our job tonight to introduce you to the Lord's church according to the New Testament, according to the word of God. And once we introduce you to the shape, unto the circle, unto the church, it is our prayer tonight that you will understand the will, the way of the Lord more perfectly. So on tonight, there is some things we want you to do. First of all, we're going to break this thing up into three different categories. We first want to show you the church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We want to show you the church in prophecy, and we'll get to that. And then we want to show you the church in confirmation. And then lastly, we want to show you the church in revelation. One more time, we want to show you the church in prophecy. Secondly, we want to show you the church in confirmation. And then lastly, we want to show you the church in revelation. So we're going to begin this study of the church, and we're going to go to Matthew's chapter number 16 before we delve in into the prophecy of Isaiah. Matthew's chapter 16, and if you would meet me there in your sanctified Bibles of the word of God, Matthew 16 and verse number 13, you will find these words in the King James Version. The Bible says, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, his disciples say,
whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?
Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Now, when we get to Matthew 16 and verse number 13, it is important to see that as Jesus comes into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, here Jesus comes into a coast that is named blessing that Jesus picks this moment to ask the question, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Here is an island. Here is a place that is built after and named after Philip the Tetrarch. But the Lord now is getting ready to make and declare something essentially important. And he wants now in this place, in this time, to give and ask a question, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Jesus does this in a place that is named after somebody who has built it up. Jesus had come to build something, and he's going to declare it in a minute. And he uses this opportunity because any place that is giving credence, any place that is built by a man, is going to have a name connected to him who built it. When this place of Caesarea Philippi, it was given credence to Caesar and named after Philip the Tetrarch. That's going to be important as we move forward, to know that Jesus wants you to understand something, that if something is built, you ought to give more credence to him who built it than the thing that was built. So the Bible says in Matthew 16, when they came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, notice this, he asked the disciples, who do men say? Now the question here is directed to the people that are outside of the Lord's circle. The Lord wants to know, what is the world saying about me? Now that's important, because before we get to the church, we must first have an understanding of who Christ is. You cannot have the church without Jesus Christ. If Jesus is not the Christ, if Jesus is just Mary's baby, if Jesus is just a carpenter's son, if Jesus is just a man from Nazareth, if Jesus is just a regular person, then the church has no power and it never comes into existence, because Jesus has to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. So Jesus asked the question, who do men say that I am? Man must first be converted to Jesus before they can become and be added to the Lord's church. You must understand who Jesus is in order to come to the Lord by faith. The Bible says you must know who he is. So in Matthew 16 and verse number 13, Jesus said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Go ahead and read. What does the Bible say? Verse 14.
And they said,
some say that thou art John the Baptist.
Some Elias.
Some say that you are Elias.
Others.
And others say
Jeremiah.
That you are Jeremiah.
Maybe
you're one of the prophets. Here we see confusion, as we see even in our world today. And I want you to know, people of God, that when you have confusion, you surely have a problem. There needs to be somebody that knows who he is. So refine. Jesus now turns the question from the external people in the world, and he now redirects his question to his men, his disciples, and he asks them, well, who do ye say that I, the Son of Man, am? And the Bible says in verse number 16, there is that impetuous, there is that leader of the rest of the apostles. It is that man by the name of Peter that steps out. Sometimes he stepped out messed up, but this time he stepped out right. Peter steps out in Matthew 16 and verse number 16. And the Bible says, and Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ. You're not just Jesus of Nazareth. You're not just Mary's baby. You are Jesus, the Christ. The Christ is his title. That's important, because the Christ would tell us that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. Jesus is the anointed of God that was prophesied, that would come and would die for the sins of the world, saving men from their sin and giving us the gift of eternal life. So we find that Peter had the question right. You are the Christ, the Son
Peter.
That thou art Peter.
And upon this rock.
And upon this rock. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Upon this rock, Jesus said, thou art Peter. Thou art Peter. Peter and rock. And we have to be careful here and know and understand that when Jesus said, thou art Peter, he uses the Greek word Petros. And the Greek word Petros is dealing with a small piece of rock. But then when Jesus says, and upon this rock, Jesus uses a different Greek word, which is Petra. The Greek word there, Petra, deals with a foundational stone. And it goes back to Isaiah 28 and 16, that Jesus is that sure rock, that sure foundation. We need to know tonight that it is not on Peter that the church was built. Peter was a piece of rock. Peter was a man that was not nothing like Jesus, because Peter was not the Christ, the Son of the living God. It could not be built on Peter, but it was built on this rock. And this rock is Petra, which is the foundation of stone, and is built on the confession that Peter made that Jesus is the Christ. And based on who Jesus is, now we have a solid foundation. Because if Jesus isn't the Christ, there is no church. If Jesus isn't the Christ, then we would be still in our sins. If Jesus was just a regular man, we would still be lost today. But I'm glad that he wasn't a man, and I'm glad that he is the truly the Son of God. So Jesus said, upon this truth, upon this confession, that I am the Petra, I am the foundational stone, I am the Christ, Jesus said, and now makes a powerful declarational statement. Now, let's take our time right along in here. Jesus said, I will. Now, very important, people of God, that we understand this important statement. The term I is exclusive and decorative. What do you mean, preacher? Exclusive. When I would tell my beloved wife, I say, honey, I will take out the trash. What I was saying to her is, you don't have to worry about the trash. My son didn't have to worry about the trash, because when I told them I would do it, I was being decorative and I was also being exclusive. That's important tonight. When Jesus says I, he is being decorative and he's also being exclusive, meaning you can't do it because you are not the foundational stone. You can't do it because you are not the Christ. Jesus said, let me make a decorative and an exclusive statement. But not only is it decorative and exclusive, it is also a promise, because he says after I, he says will. Will is promise, meaning if Jesus said it, then he must do it, because Jesus is not a man. He was God in the flesh and he cannot lie. So if he makes a promise, he must perform what he has also promised. So he says, I will, and then he said, build. Build is established. Oh, this thing is packed full. We have I, decorative and exclusive. We have will, promise, and we have build, established. The Lord will build, established. So we need to find, number one, the church that Jesus promised and he exclusively established. Then he called it my. My is possessive. My being belonging to, meaning that the Lord's church, the church belongs to him. It doesn't belong to a man. It doesn't belong to any man here on earth. The church belongs to Jesus Christ. He said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell, watch this now, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against. He did not say them, he said it. Now, why is that important, preacher? Because he uses a term that is singular and not plural. If Jesus wanted to build them, Jesus would have said them. But Jesus uses a term that is singular to help us to know that Jesus was building ministry. Amen. Amen. But I come today to tell you, the Lord says, I'm going to give the keys to his men and to Peter and the apostles. And the keys is representative of an entryway into the kingdom, which is also a synonymous term for the church. Jesus being the king and the church being his dominion. Oh, how blessed we are. So what do we have so far, preacher? Well, what do we have? I wanted to show you that, number one, the church has an exclusive and a decorative builder, and that is Jesus Christ. Jesus promised the church. Jesus said he would build or establish the church. And not only that, Jesus calls, he calls the institution a it. Now, if you're taking notes at home, you need to know that Jesus is the builder. What do we need to know about this circle? What do we need to know about this shape? What do we need to know about the church? It has a builder, and its name is Jesus. What are you saying, preacher? Number one, if you find a church that Jesus did not build, you already know you have yourself a problem. If you find a church that there is more than a singular spiritual institution, because Jesus refers to it as an in a singular body or institution, you need to know that you have yourself a problem. But we need to now go on our quick trip, and we need to look at the church in prophecy. We need to look at the church in confirmation, and we need to look at the church in revelation. But before we do that, don't forget the keys. Jesus said, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of God. I need you to know, we need to know that there are some keys, and Jesus gave the keys to Peter and the apostles. So we need to remember that. So we need to write these things down and remember that. Now, let's go to Isaiah chapter number 2. Isaiah chapter number 2. Let's go to prophecy. Now, preacher, why is prophecy important? Prophecy is important because prophecy will let us know about the church in foretelling. Prophecy is when a prophet of God speaks about future events by divine revelation of God. And here we see a major prophet in Isaiah speaks about the future coming of the Lord's church. In Isaiah chapter 2 and verse number 1, we find the word of God. In Isaiah 2 and verse number 1, the Bible says, and the word of God. Go ahead and read the word that Isaiah, go ahead and read. The son of Amos.
Saul concerning Judea.
Saul concerning Saul. So that God gave him a prophetic vision. He gave him a vision of something to come. He saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Make sure you write this down. Now, Isaiah sees a vision. The vision is concerning the information that's in the vision. In the prophecy is concerning Judah. Judah is the family line in which Jesus, the Messiah, would come down from. Then you have Jerusalem. Jerusalem will be the place in which the Lord's church is going to be established. Why is that important, preacher? Because we're defining the circle. And in defining the circle, we have defined the builder. We have defined that it shall be established. We have defined that it is the Bible says in verse number 2, and it shall come to pass. That's future language, our prophetic language. It shall come to pass in the last days. Go ahead and read.
That the mountain of the Lord's house.
That the mountain of the Lord's house.
Shall be established.
Now, that's good. In the last days. Many of us, you hear people say all the time, we're in the last days. The last days is representative of understanding the dispensations of time. You had, as many of us would break it into three dispensations, could surely be specifically broken into many more than that. But we would prefer it to, the, as we say in the Sunday school, I break it down that way, patriarchal dispensation, when God spoke to the fathers and the fathers spoke to their families. Then you have the Mosaic dispensation, where God gave the law to Moses, and Moses and the prophets spoke the word of God to Israel. Then we have what we're in now, is the last days of the Christian dispensation. When Christ died at Calvary, he ushered in the last days of the Christian dispensation. So we're now, the prophecy that Isaiah speaks about, he says, this one will come to pass in that last dispensation. So that has to be after the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Whatever Isaiah is about to give to us is going to happen after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. All right, go ahead and read.
And shall be exalted.
It shall be established. God said, Jesus said, build here. Isaiah says, establish. Amen. What are we looking for? We're looking for the church that the Lord built, of the church that Jesus established. Go ahead and read.
Above the hills.
Above the hills.
All nations.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. We need to write something else down. We found ourselves a builder in Matthew chapter 16 and verse number 18. And now we have found that there will be all nations. And wait a minute, preacher. I think that Isaiah speaks like Jesus. Isaiah didn't call them. He didn't call what Jesus established them in the plural. But Isaiah speaks like Jesus in the singular. What are you doing, preacher? I'm showing you the likeness, the same way Jesus talked about the built institution, the church, same way Isaiah talks about it, because he said, all nations shall flow unto it. Jesus said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Wait a minute, I have an it with Jesus, and I have an it with Isaiah, but then Isaiah gives us more information, and he says, all nations, wait a minute, preacher, are you saying it doesn't matter what my nationality would be when it came to the Lord's church that he was going to build? It did not matter, no sir, no ma'am. It didn't matter your nationality. I want you to understand the Lord has prophesied through his prophet Isaiah that when the church would be established, all nations would be represented. All nations would be represented there on the day the church was established. What are you saying, preacher? If you're in an institution that was not established in Jerusalem, you need to check that institution, because it doesn't fit the shape of the New Testament church. If you're in an institution that says any institution to do, you want to check that institution, because the Lord referred to it as it, a singular institution. You need to understand today that the Lord has told us that there is a singular institution that belongs and would be established by Jesus Christ. Go ahead and read what the Bible has to say. All nations and will go unto it. Go ahead and read.
And many people.
Many people.
Shall go. And
many people. Wait a minute. Many people. We're going to see on that day if there's a little bit of people. If there'll be many people. Go ahead and read.
Shall go and say.
Shall go and say.
Come ye.
Come ye.
And let us go up to the
mountain. Let us go up to the mountain. Jerusalem was a mountainous area. And that's why he said, let us go up to the mountain, to the Lord. Read.
To the house of God.
To the house of God.
Of the God of Jacob.
Of the God of Jacob.
And he will teach us.
And he will teach us his ways. Read.
And we will walk.
We will walk in his paths. Read.
For out of Zion.
For out of Zion. will happen at Jerusalem. Well, what do you need, preacher? Well, let's review thus far. What do we have so far? What do we have so far? We have thus far. We have Jesus being the builder of this institution. We have the place. What is the place? The place is Jerusalem. Well, what do we have being at Jerusalem? We have all nations. Well, we need to find out some more information. We also know that there will be some keys that will be talked about on that day. So we have a builder. His name is Jesus the Christ. We have a place, and the place is Jerusalem. We even know how many nations would be represented, for the Bible said all nations shall flow unto it. Well, we're not done yet, because now we need to go to Jesus, and Jesus is going to confirm. We need confirmation. Jesus is going to confirm what Isaiah prophesied. So we go to Luke chapter number 24. Luke chapter 24 and verse number 44. Luke chapter 44, 24 and verse number 44. And now we will get confirmation for the prophecy of Isaiah. Now watch what Jesus says as we catch you up here. We are in the place. We are in a place where Jesus has risen from the dead. Jesus has gotten up the third day. He walks as there are some men that are traveling on the road of Emmaus. And they are traveling. They have went to the sepulcher and had not seen the body of Jesus. So they're now leaving and they're doubting that Jesus had truly risen. Jesus has now joined these men, but he makes himself holy that they could not tell who he was. And these men said and were sad. And Jesus said, "What are you sad about?" As I paraphrase. And Jesus walks with them. And the blessing is, Jesus tells them some pertinent information that me and you need to know. And in that information, he also confirms what Isaiah prophesied. So when we get to Luke 24 and verse 44, the Bible says what? Go ahead and read.
And he said unto them.
And he said unto them.
These are the words.
These are the words.
Unto you.
That I spake unto you.
When I was yet with you.
When he was yet with them before he was crucified. Go ahead and read.
That all things must be fulfilled.
Now watch this. All things must be fulfilled. Fulfilling what? Prophecy. Everything that was prophesied, likened unto what we've already read in Isaiah chapter 2. Jesus said everything that was prophesied had to be fulfilled. Go ahead and read.
Which were written in the law of Moses.
It was written in the law of Moses. Read it.
In the prophet.
Isaiah is a prophet. Go ahead and read.
And in the Psalms.
And in the Psalms, David wrote about it. Read. Concerning everything back there. Who is it talking about? It was talking about the Messiah to come. Go ahead and read.
Open their understanding.
This is what we want to do tonight. What do you want to do tonight, preacher? We want to open your understanding. We want to ensure tonight that you walk away from this sermonic dissertation understanding that Jesus has done a great work. Jesus has built and established his institution. Many people read the Bible, but the question is, do you properly understand what you read? We see that in Acts chapter 8 when there was a eunuch on the way back from worship, and the Bible said the Spirit of God told Philip, join yourself with that man. And as that man read from the book of Isaiah, Philip asked the man a mighty question. Understandeth what thou readest? Many people read, but the question is, do you understand? So the Bible says, go ahead and read.
That they might understand the scriptures.
They needed to understand the scriptures. Go ahead and read.
And said unto them.
Said unto them.
Thus it is written.
Thus it is written.
And thus it behooved.
Thus it behooved God.
Christ to suffer.
Yeah, Jesus had to
rise from the dead.
And had to rise on the third day. Go ahead and read.
And that repentance.
And wait a minute. We have another addition to our circle. We are looking for the sake. We're looking for the Lord's church, and we're trying to find it. Well, what have we found so far? We found a builder, and his What do we need to go now, preacher? We need to find Jerusalem. We need to find it. And when we find Jerusalem, let's see if we can find all nations. And when we find all nations, let's see if we can find the keys. And when we find the keys, because Peter and the apostles are going to bring us the keys. And when we find the keys, we're going to find us repentance and remission of sins. We're going to find the Lord's church, because it's going to begin at Jerusalem. Isaiah prophesied it. Jesus said, I'll build it. Isaiah said it's going to be established in the top of the mountains, in the place of Jerusalem. All nations will flow unto it. Jesus confirms Isaiah's prophecy and says, all nations is going to be preached in my name among all nations, beginning where, Jesus? Beginning at Jerusalem. He says the same place that Isaiah said. He called it in Matthew 16, and Isaiah said, all nations will flow unto it. Everything is coming together. Now we need to bring all the pieces together, and we need to find the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 1, as we come now to the end of the sermon. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 1, we find the Bible, the Word of God. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 1. Go ahead and read.
And when the day of Pentecost,
when the day of Pentecost
was fully come, they were all with one accord.
They were all with one accord in one place.
And suddenly,
there came
a sound from heaven.
Jesus had told them in Acts chapter 1 that they had to stay in Jerusalem. then every case after it should be the same as case number one. Because Peter is giving us the keys on how to get in the kingdom of God. The Bible said, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ by the authority that Jesus has ordained. And the Bible says, what is it for? For the remission, the pardoning, the removal of one's sins. And then after that, the Lord will give them with the Holy Ghost the indwelling of God's Spirit. God is not going to give you His Spirit until after sins have been removed. And once sins have been removed, then the Lord will give you His Spirit. And the Bible says, as Peter goes on and we close, for the promise is unto you, and I say this to you tonight, the promise is unto you and your children, as many of you are far off, as many as our Lord God shall call by the same gospel message, because this was the beginning. And the Bible says, and with many other words did Peter exhort, saying, save yourselves. I tell you today, you need to save yourself. Well, how did they save themselves? We see how they understood what Peter said by how they responded to save yourselves from this untoward generation. The Bible said, then they that gladly received the word that Peter preached, they didn't say a prayer. They didn't accept Jesus in their heart. The Bible says they were baptized the same day. Why the same day? Because baptism, at the occasion of baptism, is where God works on us and removes our sins. So they did it not the third Sunday, not baptism Sunday. They did it the same day because they understood that baptism was for the pardoning of their sins, and it was the keys of entrance into the kingdom the Lord sets. That's what the Bible says in Acts 2:47. And they were praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church to the number daily such as should be saved. So on tonight, we beckon you with the gospel call. We have showed you that Jesus made a declaration, I will be healed. Isaiah prophesied, it will be established. And he said that all nations would be there in the city of Jerusalem. Jesus confirmed it in Luke 24. He said, repentance and remission of sins will be preached in my name among all nations. And we see the confirmation, the revelation is given to us in Acts chapter 2. The church is revealed and established on the day of Pentecost, AD 33. And I come today to tell you, if you're looking for the Lord's church, you need to find the one that was established in Jerusalem. The same church that was there, that was established on the day of Pentecost, where all nations were represented there on that day, where repentance and remission of sins should be preached. That's what should be preached even today. The same message that Peter preached should be preached even today. But the problem is, somebody has made a different set of keys. Somebody has made a different set of keys. And the reason why we have a different plan of salvation rolling around in the world, because there's different churches and different institutions that have been established. But I come today to tell you that if you want to get in the church that Jesus built, you must take the same keys that were cut over 2,000 years ago, the same keys that Jesus gave to his apostles, because the grass may wither, the flower thereof may fade away, but the word of God endureth forever. And if the keys get folk into the church, even then, I come today to tell you, the same keys get you into the kingdom, the same church today. We thank you so much. May God keep you, and may God bless you. And it is our prayer that you may now identify the church of the Bible. Amen. Verse number one, the Bible gives us the prophecy of the great prophet Isaiah. Luke, okay. All right. Then we have in Luke chapter number 24, the Lord gives us, we see, confirmation of the word that Isaiah has already prophesied. Now, confirmation is, okay, all right. Then we see the church in Revelation in Acts chapter number 2 and verse number 1. We will find, got it. All right, Doc.